Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Sunday Wire. I'm your host, Patrick Henningsen. We're streaming out live on the Alternate Current Radio Network and also at 21stCenturyWire.com. A fantastic segment before the break with the Syrian Girl. If you missed any of the live broadcasts, if you're joining us late this week, you can catch this on the podcasting platforms after the show on iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, and a number of other platforms, Spreaker.com as well. Now, our next guest, we're very happy to have finally caught up with our next guest. He is a veteran, I would say reporter, probably doesn't like using the term journalist. We can talk about that, but he's intrepid, more so than a lot of people who are reporting, has been on the ground in a number of countries, has seen a number of things, certainly in terms of revolutions, color revolutions, uprisings, the sort of things that we're seeing so much of in the last few months. He's just recently come back from an extended assignment in Hong Kong, right there in the sort of middle of what was going on there over the last couple of months. His name is Andre Vilcek. He is also reporting for RT and a number of other outlets, too many probably to mention here. There's a link to his publishing company as well on the show page. And he's joining us now on the live link from Asia. Hello, Andre.
Hello, Patrick. Nice being on your show, finally.
Yes, it's great. Great to have you, Andre. And, you know, I've just followed your work vicariously around the world through your articles that are very descriptive. You've also, well, people can go to your to the link to your publishing company on the show page. You've also written a few books as well. You've worked on a number of documentary films. So I think you're probably very well qualified to comment on what's going on right now in the world. A lot of people, Andre, have said there are so many uprisings and protests going on simultaneously. So my first question to you is, have they always been going on, or are we just more aware that these are going on now, or is there a noticeable increase in these types of events? How are you seeing this right now globally?
Well, Patrick, there are simultaneously going on two types of uprisings. And unfortunately, the Western mass media tries to put them all together and create some kind of a goulash by mixing them all together. So we have this, let's separate them somehow. There is a Hong Kong, there are Hong Kong riots happening already for several months. And I was based in a city for a couple of weeks. I have a history with Hong Kong for actually some 20 years. But lately I spent 2 weeks there and commented a lot through my writing, but also through RT, Press TV, and other outlets about what's going on. So that's one type of, and we will come back to this. That's one type of uprising, or I call it more a riot. Then the second type is really a revolutionary movement that is sweeping several countries all over the world, and they are as diverse as Lebanon and Chile. And we will talk about this as well. But first, to Hong Kong. Look, the West is already trying for many, many years and months to do everything possible to discredit and to provoke China. It doesn't stop at anything. I recently wrote an entire book, which will be very soon published. It's about the Uyghurs in Northwest China, which is again the rallying cry of the Western mass media. Uyghurs are being depicted as victims and so on. But in reality, there is an enormous attempt to use Uyghurs by the West and by Turkey to destroy Chinese Belt and Road Initiative. So Uyghurs are injected, have been injected by Turkey and the West into Syria. They operate in Afghanistan and so on. And their only purpose is to get as hardened as possible and to return to China and to break China to pieces. So I wrote the whole book. I investigated in Afghanistan, in Indonesia, in Syria itself, next to Idlib, and in Turkey. So that's one attempt to destabilize China. Of course, there is Taiwan, there is South China Sea, we can talk about it later, but Hong Kong is definitely one of the hot spots that was depicted lately by the West. The West is using frustration of Hong Kong young people. And here is a paradox. What is happening in Hong Kong is actually very paradoxical. The young people in Hong Kong, many of them actually are frustrated with turbo capitalist system, which the city has, and with the British legacy, of British colonialist legacy. So what do we have in Hong Kong? The highest prices on earth. It's the most expensive city on earth. We pay $700 even to park your car from Monday to Friday for 1 month, only during the working hours. $700. You pay $1.2 million in Hong Kong for tiny apartment, for tiny condominium, which is not even new and it's not even in the in the very center. Young people cannot get jobs. They graduate. From universities, from decent universities, they cannot get a decent job that would guarantee them at least some kind of a basic standard of living, and when they could survive in their own city. So they're very frustrated, they are actually channeling their frustration at the absolutely wrong target, because all these things that they are protesting against are being addressed across the borderline or across the line by the People's Republic of China, which is leaving actually Hong Kong behind. The Chinese cities like Shenzhen, Guangzhou, but also Xi'an, not to speak about Shanghai or Beijing, are now counting on much better cultural life, much better infrastructure, huge public areas, even things like exercise machines for the kids or for the elderly people. Well, Hong Kong is living this total capitalist nightmare. So logically, the young people in Hong Kong should be demanding more Beijing, not lesser Beijing. But they are brainwashed already for many, many years, and they are actually, many of them are financed by the US, by UK, by other Western countries, to protest and to do maximum possible damage to China and to China's reputation. So they are actually protesting against Beijing, Beijing's so-called rule, while they should be protesting against the archaic, horrible laws, including the law which was supposed to be challenged by the extradition law that was recently cancelled. So we have this absolutely absurd situation. And these kids don't want to hear anything that would be contrary to their ideas about how the world is arranged. This uprising is nothing new. There was a first wave of it, was so-called umbrella revolution. It was in 2014, and these people already then didn't want to listen about anything negative that was coming from the West. You could ask them about Iraq, you could ask them about Afghanistan. Then they wouldn't beat you up, but they would really be very aggressive with you. And now they beat up people who are challenging them up, actually, and they call it fight for democracy. You ask them, what do they want? And they would say, we want democracy. And you ask them, what is democracy from your point of view? And they would say, well, it's what they have in the West. But then it ends, because there is not really much they can tell about how so-called democracy is implemented in the parts of the world that are, occupied by the West, intimidated by the West, or attacked by the West. So that's Hong Kong, and the Western media, mass media, is extremely supportive of them. Actually, I was watching Western media at work. I was filming them working, actually, in Hong Kong, because it was so ridiculous. It was so absolutely absurd. You would have Western media, journalists, camera people filming protesters, waving American flags, yelling that they want to be liberated by the United States. These protesters were walking through the downtown, you know, just singing U.S. national anthems and so on. 50 meters away or 100 meters away, the rioters would be destroying public property like subway stations, railing that's supposed to protect people from falling under the cars on the separating sidewalks and highways. And there was no Western camera person filming this. So whenever the protesters or so-called protesters, the rioters really, would start destroying the public property, attacking police, intimidating people, even beating up people for waving Chinese flags. I mean, we're talking about China, right? I mean, Hong Kong is part of China. So they would be beating people waving Chinese flags. There were no UK or US camera people capturing this. They were capturing the glorious moments of these people yelling through their masks, actually, that were covering their faces about democracy and freedom and I don't know what. So, you know, I mean, In some countries in the West, you cannot even now for Muslim people, it's forbidden to wear to have their faces covered. But to wear face covers while attacking police in Hong Kong just because police is seen as some kind of a pro-Chinese force, that's allowed. It's even supported. So that's about Hong Kong in brief.
And the mask thing is very interesting because you know, I remember when the WTO, the first big WTO protests in America, they were in Seattle. You probably remember.
Yes.
I think this was back in the late 90s, 98, 99. And that's when I first saw people kind of masked up, basically. And Black Bloc sort of emerged from that, these anarchist groups. And so yes. I saw what was going on in Hong Kong. And there's a photograph that you took that is just amazing. It's you're looking down under an underpass, and I just see thousands of young people with masks on, waiting to come up from under the underpass. I don't know if you know what photo I'm talking about.
I know from Hong exactly. Kong. It was yes. They look like ninjas. You know, their culture is actually extremely. It's a pop culture. It's a selfie generation culture, and you know, I think this is how they got these people, the West. You know, they basically they were nobody. They couldn't get jobs. They were kind of living in houses and apartments of their parents because they couldn't afford their own habitat, and they were frustrated with the fact that Hong Kong is losing its edge over China. In fact, it lost the edge over mainland China because Chinese cities are in much better shape and they're very optimistic and so on. So they suddenly felt that this is their moment in time in history, and they actually can, this will be the probably most important a moment in their life. This is what will be remembered about them. And it's typical selfie thing. So on one hand, they're covering their faces. And I know the photo you're talking about. On the other hand, they really are dying to be exposed, to be listened to, even if they say nothing significant. So it is actually, if you analyze this, it's a very sad, very pathetic thing. You know, I went to the old British jail, which is under the Chinese rule. It was converted into the wonderful, wonderful cultural center. It's a tremendous cultural center consisting on several buildings and layers and all that. Before it, they used to beat Hong Kong people. The Brits used to pull down their pants like in Punjab and India and just cane them, you know, like humiliate them like little children. So now there is this cultural center. And I went to talk to a curator. He was a very nice man, 65 years old, old man, and you know, he said something that really depict the reality of this riots. He said, you know, what they achieved is that The families are now divided. It never happened in Hong Kong. Father is afraid to talk to his son or daughter. He said, this is not Chinese culture. This is not, it never happened like this before. But this is what they did. And they intimidate their own family members, as they do intimidate, of course, people in the malls and at the subway stations and so on. And this man was just so sad because it appeared that something was dying in his city. You know, it was at least the respect that here in Asia exists towards the older generations, whether we agree with it or not. But that's how Chinese culture, that's on what the Chinese culture is being based. And these young people are actually destroying it, but destroying for what? They're fighting their own country. Whatever they want it or not, Hong Kong is part of China. China is their country. And they're treasonously throwing the Chinese flags to the bay. And then they ask President Trump, please liberate us from China. How can somebody liberate you from yourself?
Yeah, it's amazing flying American and British flags. And as you pointed out, Andrea, it was no utopia under British rule, Hong Kong.
Oh, no.
Certainly wasn't.
Remember the old photographs, and not so old photographs, when actually people were living in slums Hong Kong, and these slums were just so horrific that now it's when they are gone, there is a photo, permanent like photo exhibition, memorial park about this. I mean, it was just horrific, and they were torturing people, they were killing people, the Brits, they were caning people, and these kids don't remember, they don't know. You know, one of the flags they're waving is the British flag with the Hong Kong colonial British flag that was used by the Empire, by the British Empire. They are waving this. They want this back. They have no idea. You know, make Hong Kong Great Britain again is one of the logos that they were using. You know, it's like Trump is saying, make America great again. So, I mean, this is what they use. So in 2014, they had English bulldog, and they had as a symbol, they had Churchill as a symbol. You know, it's just absolutely unbelievable. And look what China is doing, the mainland China. It's doing basically nothing. Again, if you compare how the Gilets Jaunes, the Yellow Vests are treated, the Barcelona, the Catalan independence movement is treated. This is nothing. In China, then, if you compare it to Ecuador or to Chile, where we are going to go soon, about which we are going to talk soon, you know, it's just totally ridiculous. Look, I covered many, many riots, wars, demonstrations all over the world. Okay, we don't have to go to extremes. We don't have to go to Afghanistan or something. But even in the countries like Turkey or countries like Peru, when the demonstrators are encountering police is shooting water full of excrements and urine. Very often, the gas they were using during the Gezi Park uprising in Istanbul or in Egypt when there were protests against Morsi, you would die from this. People were covering themselves by anything because if it would hit you to the gas, you would just collapse totally. And we were carrying people in Egypt and in Turkey and in Peru, to the cars and away from the action because the gas itself could totally knock you out. In Hong Kong, the gas they are using is like of the mildest nature. The water they are using is basically the famous potable water of Hong Kong. You can drink the stuff. You know, so this is the only thing they can, and they protest against the police brutality now. You know, they throw the bottles, they throw Molotovs basically at the police, and then they protest about police brutality, and because it's a selfie thing. You know, that's what they want to feel. They want to feel that they are heroes, that they want to feel they are great liberators of Hong Kong. And you know what? They cannot stand them, the majority of people. I'm going back in December. I was invited by people are writing to me. They said, please come back. The Hong Kong citizens, they said, please come back because we are the silent majority that you mentioned. We want to talk to you. And these are people who are pro Beijing, or these are like business people. There is no like a group that you could just say that it's so diverse. People who cannot stand this this so-called uprising. And they were hated already 4 or 5 years ago by their own fellow citizens, because for them, Hong Kong people are very pragmatic. You know, they just want to go on with their life, and this is destroying the city totally. The tourist arrivals are down. They were down 40%. Now, I don't know. The economy is going to shrink. Can you imagine? I mean, it's in North Asia, this is unthinkable, except in Japan. So basically, they're destroying the infrastructure, they're destroying the economy, and they're destroying confidence. People are moving businesses, even businesses. They want capitalism, they want the West. Well, Western companies are moving to Singapore and Shanghai. You know, they don't speak English in Hong Kong. They want Great Britain back, but they don't speak English. They don't speak Mandarin out of spite. So they all speak Cantonese. They don't. So people go to Singapore, which is much more pro-Chinese, and where people speak everything. They speak English, they speak Mandarin, and they speak Cantonese. They speak everything there. Or they go to Shanghai, which is a much more pleasant and much more exciting city. So they are shooting themselves to the foot. Instead of trying to reform the city and make it great through cultural diversity, through innovative thinking, they just are making everybody mad in the region by calling Brits and Americans back to turn their city into a colony.
And we'll move on to Chile in a second, but before we do, you brought up a point I just think we need to touch on, because I think you brought up something that is incredibly important. You talked about the separating of the generations, pitting the young against the old, especially in Chinese culture. That's a big thing, because the respect for elders and the respect for the older generation, as you said, society is constructed around this concept. And there's a film that we have featured on our main section today. It's called The Revolution Business, and it talks about agencies like Opdoor that receive quite a lot of U.S. funding from USAID over the years, or the State Department, like the National Endowment for Democracy. But there's these regime change or revolution agencies. Now, this one sprouted out of Serbia, actually. It's called Canvas now. But they train activists. And there's different kinds of methods of training. The reframing is a term that's used in this. It's a corporate concept that's made its way into activism. So when you talked about the generations pitting the young against the old, they do the same with gender in traditional societies, women against men, and kind of injecting these Western commercialized concepts of political identity, for instance, or generational identity, all these things that are so effective at selling products in the West over the years. It's almost like it's been weaponized. Do you think that there's a kind of a, do you think this is being seeded in a place like Hong Kong by Western? Go ahead.
Most definitely, Patrick, most definitely. Sorry, there was an echo a little bit. It was breaking, but now it's fine again, the signal. Yes, what you said is absolutely correct. And they use many different things. They are lightening up the entire, they are discrediting also the idea of the socialism, of communism. Of course, they implant these ideas against the People's Republic of China. And no matter how successful peaceful People's Republic is, they will always find a way how to recruit the young kids in places like Hong Kong. They turn consumerism into pop. They turn it into something hip. So they basically inject young people with the ideas that, look, to be a communist or to be a good citizen of China or building your fatherland or building your country is something very outdated and very boring. And you are like nobody. If you do this, if you believe in this, you are nobody. You are just not, you are not living in 21st century. Now to protest against communism is hip, you know, to protest against, your country is hip. And they do it only, of course, against the countries that they want to discredit. And this is where the big contrast comes with what we see in the places like Chile or in like Ecuador or in in Lebanon. So here at the beginning of the show, we said that the Western media is actually trying to create this one big goulash, one big cocktail out of all this. They mix all this and they say, well, you see, this is what is happening in the 21st century. Now we are dealing with all the uprising, Hong Kong, Santiago, Beirut. Well, actually these uprisings have nothing in common except that they are going against the savage right-wing capitalism. In Hong Kong, kids are not aware that what really irks them, what makes them so unhappy is capitalism. They were brainwashed into believing that it's because of the influence of China. Contrary is the truth. But in places like Beirut or Santiago or in Quito, they finally understood. I mean, Chile is awakening, is a symbol, is a rallying cry of the people. And Chile is actually very dangerous place for the West, for the demagogues and propagandists in the West, because Chile is tremendously educated country. I lived there for many years, and I will soon live there again. I love the country, despite all this, right-wing returning for a while. Like it's a country of poets, of two Nobel Prizes for poetry. It's a country of dreamers, and it's a country where people like Freire and great educators actually used to operate before 1973, September 11, 1973 coup performed by the people like Kissinger and the Chase Manhattan and ITT. So it used to be, and it still is, tremendously powerful. It's a intellectual powerhouse. And in Chile, after Pinochet stepped down, after the US and Western-backed dictator Pinochet stepped down, Chile was not poor, but it had the worst distribution of wealth in Latin America. So after that, the socialist governments came to power, and many would argue that they were not really socialist, that they were center-left and all this, and they were, but they were. Actually, there was an attempt by the society to recreate again socialist Chile that was destroyed on 9/11/73 by Pinochet's coup. So the attempt lasted for many years. And of course, country improved, despite the fact that it was not too left, it was center-left. Corruption was low, small, relatively manageable, the economy was growing tremendously. It was Chile became the country on the level of the European Union nations like Czech Republic or Czechia, now they call it, or Greece or Portugal, or richer even than Greece and Portugal. Well, Human Development Index, it became one of the, but it still had this, an equally distributed income. And then plus what happened was actually terrible, because as I am mentioning now in my latest essay, it's almost like quoting great French writer Albert Camus and his novel Plague. At the end of the novel, you know, when Plague is fascism, at the end of the novel, when the doctors are actually metaphorically fighting the plague, the doctor who was chief physician in fighting it and winning it, he said, well, and I paraphrase, he said, yes, it's great we won, but, you know, plague never disappears. It hides under the, you know, in the walls, it cracks in the walls, it hides in the ceiling, and then it's one moment without you realizing it will send its rats to one of the happy cities. And this is exactly what happened in Chile. You know, it was all looking so well, but the fascism from Pinochet era was sitting there somewhere in the elites, among the elites, among the people who were controlling the right-wing political parties like Piñera, you know, the president. And suddenly it hit. Suddenly people realized that it is there again, controlling the society. And so when the government was going to raise the subway or metro fare by only 4 cents, the country erupted because they understood something is wrong. You know, you have this country like on par with maybe France in terms of standard of living, and you have slums. Okay, of course, slums. France has slums too now. But it has slums, and it has people in the villages living on like $300, $400. That's not right. And Chilean people, they always were dreaming about the egalitarian society. And something broke, they understood. And that's where the slogan Chile woke up came to. And these people are fighting now for democracy, real democracy, not this pathetic slogan of democracy. They know what democracy is. They died for democracy after 73. They were dying for decades in fighting Pinochet in the mountains, the MIR, for example, movement and all this. Women were raped, but they were still fighting after being released. It's a very brave nation, you know, and so I think they understood that this fascism is somehow back, and now they are not going to back up. They are going to fight until Piñera is going to resign. He offered today, yesterday, that he's going to sack the ministers. He's going to totally reshuffle the government. It's not enough. This is not enough. They were fooled. They knew, they know, the people of Chile, they know that they were fooled with this so-called democracy. They voted for Piñera, you know? They voted for him the second time. First time, then in Chile, you can be only president for one term, and then there has to be someone in between, and then you can be reelected. He was once already the president. Then socialist Michel Bachelet became president again, and now he's back in La Moneda, in the presidential palace. But this is tremendous fight. This is tremendous struggle, and it's not Hong Kong. You know, the people died. 18 people died, 17 people died, they are not sure. You know, some died in a supermarket that was burning, but 5 people died fighting in the hands of police. People, thousands are were arrested. People are tortured. Can you imagine the trauma for the older generation when who remember Pinochet? They have tanks in the streets of Santiago. They have armed vehicles. They have military kicking their children to the head. You know, this is...
It's unbelievable. I never thought I would see that again in that country, considering what has happened in history. That the images were so strong before that you'd think that would be just such a deterrent for that to return, that kind of military overlord situation. But it has. I find that incredible, Andre.
I cannot believe it. Look, I lived there. I still remember my best friend, a Chilean architect and photographer. I still remember 3 years after dictatorship collapse, we were driving together, and police stopped us for speeding. I was going like 20 kilometers over the speed limit, and nothing happened. Oh, you know, and we just paint some fine, or I don't remember. And then I looked at my friend, he's a famous architect, and he was shaking. He was sweating next to me, you know? Because the, for him to encounter Paco, the police, was like, you know, anything could happen. He could disappear. I could disappear. His best friend. You know, it was just terrible. And this is what the older generation of people now lives through. I mean, they. But look at this enormous hope in Chile. Look at these young girls who are MPs now. They are fighting. They are at the barricades. The young people, the old people, all together. You know, I mean, it's a tremendous 1 million march rejection of you know. Compromises that are coming from Piñera, and it's beautiful because look, it's they are going to win. I know they are going to win, and I know that basically there is going to be this is already the new wave of the Latin America taking back its left-wing movements. It's incredible, basically, what is happening. We see it in Argentina. We see it where the elections are just happening. We saw it in Bolivia. It's a return, and I think in Ecuador the same thing will happen too, because the Lenin Moreno betrayed the people. He betrayed the trust. He betrayed Korea first, and now he's betraying the nation.
And do you think there's a correlation? And just take a step back and look at some of these situations. And I know that each of these uprisings, each of these political situations in these different countries are unique on number of levels. And like you said, you can't throw them all into one goulash or soup as the mainstream press likes to do and politicians like to do. But do you think there's a correlation between the amount of debt that a country is being forced to take on? And just look at Ecuador as an example. The IMF were just throwing money at this country over the last 2 years, especially. And you have structural deficiencies that really have to do with not being self-sufficient, not being able to manage your own economy, being dependent on foreign loans and aid, and your markets are full of foreign products and things like this. If you don't fix those problems, then you would just kind of remain in this cycle, this inhale exhale between fascism and kind of left wing uprisings. But the structural problems of the countries never leave. In other words, I think the U.S. has such power. The Western countries have such power to dictate these economic structures with these countries that if they can't break free from that, it's very difficult to, you know, get escape velocity, as they call it. Andre, what are your thoughts on this issue?
Well, basically, the IMF, the World Bank, they had such a negative influence on Latin America. In Latin America, people see them as an extended arm of the Western imperialism. So it's what happened in Argentina during the presidency of Cristina Kirchner and her husband. They created some sort of They created some sort of environment in which it was understood by the people of Argentina that these organizations cannot be allowed to interfere in the way the country is being governed. Then after this enormous campaign to discredit Kirchner's, the similar campaign that always happens in Latin America against the progressive presidents, as happened in Brazil, or has happened in Ecuador, and recently in Bolivia, after these enormous media campaigns, financed, of course, by the West, and very often by the international, so-called international organizations, the revolution was derailed. And in the case of Argentina, President Macri came to power. And Macri is like a Thatcherite. He's a neoliberal. But, you know, these people managed to get to power through the propaganda that was bombarded against the socialist governments. You know, usually what is used as a sword against is corruption. Corruption is always something that is thrown against our people, against the left in Latin America. So you have, for instance, a situation when they find something, like in case of Brazil, they find that some company painted the apartment of Lula. So Lula gets thrown to jail and he cannot run for president. But these countries, like Brazil, like Argentina, like Chile, these countries actually had such horrible dictatorships, totally corrupt, not by painting apartment or even giving apartment. They were corrupted to the point when they were stealing everything from their own countries. So these things are put on the same. And if you have a good media, propaganda machine, then you can convince people about anything, and then they vote this. Right-wing fascist governments like that of Macri, like Piñera in Chile, or Bolsonaro in Brazil. So I think this is all a tremendous involvement from abroad, from the West, and it was like this for decades.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and how has Venezuela been able to avoid a lot of this kind of tumultuous upheavals? They've sort of, with all that's happened to Venezuela over the last, say, 18 months, they've somehow, with hyperinflation and everything, they've somehow managed to remain stable. And a lot of people think this is incredible. What's the difference between Venezuela and some of these other countries in Latin America?
Well, actually, in Venezuela, it was interesting. I was in Rome 2 months ago, speaking at Sapienza University, and I met the chargé d'affaires of Venezuelan embassy to Italy, and we had a nice chat. And she said, "Look, the West is talking about the crisis in Venezuela, but look at our performance in education, in vaccination, with all these things. A country, despite all the horror that it was thrown into, is functioning relatively well. And it is functioning. Look, it is functioning relatively well, although, of course, there is a huge immigration because of economical. So they try to turn Venezuela into Syria. But somehow they are not succeeding because countries like China, like Russia, but also Iran and other and Cuba, of course, they caught the crisis long before it managed to degenerate or deteriorate to the Syrian level. So Venezuela, of course, is struggling, but Venezuela has a very powerful. The government of Venezuela has very powerful support from the lower classes and from the also thinking Venezuelans, from the intellectual, I hate to call it elites, but from Venezuelan
intelligentsia.
Intelligentsia, yes. So it is. Actually incredible, because again there is this revolutionary pathos which helped Cuba to survive, right, in the at the beginning during all the struggle and the embargoes and collapse of the Soviet Union support and all that. So basically Venezuela didn't manage to avoid being terrorized and being attacked. But Venezuela actually mobilized its forces, and it also managed to mobilize its allies. And Venezuela at some point was in a similar situation as Cuba during the collapse of the Soviet Union. Actually, except one or two countries, nobody was too much supportive of it. And then things changed again. Now Russia, China, Iran, Cuba, Bolivia, they are all standing with Venezuela. It's not really discussed very much in Western media, but it is incredible how the country managed to survive and to become stronger. Now, they do many things right. I mean, I have a friend who is a former World Bank economist who turned around and attacked the World Bank. He's helping them to de-dollarize. He's helping the government of Venezuela to de-dollarize. There are many ways to actually deal with the situation. They need to diversify their economy, of course, which they didn't have time. I talked to Venezuelan government people, and they admitted that it was a mistake to not to diversify economy when the dollar, when the oil was prices for oil were high and all that. So what they did actually was to try to distribute wealth among the people. They were too busy fighting poverty. They were too busy creating this patria grande, big motherland or big fatherland, sorry, of Latin America. And they didn't pay too much attention to economy, and that was a mistake. But all these things are now being analyzed, and I think Venezuela has a great potential to survive. It looked like the West is going to, U.S. is going to attack, and they got bloody nose, because they would have to really fight. You know, Venezuela is not Syria. Syria is a great nation. They're very tough fighters. They are very patriotic, but their terrain is not so great for fighting. But Venezuela is like, you cannot win. If you really attack Venezuela, you cannot win the war there, because you have jungle, deep impenetrable jungle next to Canaima. You have Andes, you know, covered by lower altitudes, covered by forests. You cannot. It's basically partisan war. Would erupt, and there is no way to win the war against Venezuela if the country is determined. And they got scared. The West got scared. They didn't dare to really attack.
Yeah, and I think they're also really relying on Colombia to be the junior partner in that effort. And that's for all the reasons you just mentioned right there. That's hugely problematic.
Yes, it can backfire. It can backfire big time, because Colombia actually is Colombia has its own horrific problems, actually much bigger than Venezuela. I mean, Colombians used to go to Venezuela searching for jobs, and not even recently when Venezuelan economy was not doing so great, and they have of course insurgency, the peace talks and all this collapsed, and they are really facing if they are going to push Venezuela too hard, it can really create the uprising in their own country, or to intensify the civil war. And look what happened in Brazil too. When Bolsonaro tried to talk Brazilian military into possible intervention in Venezuela, you remember what happened? The top brass of Brazil said, no, this is not what we are going to do. Because they have historically very good... So Bolsonaro himself, if he's going to push Brazilian military too far, he may actually pay the price, which many of us, of course, hope that he will pay the big price, because it's totally unbelievable that somebody like him is the biggest country in Latin America.
And so we've just got a few minutes left, and we spoke about Lebanon earlier in the show with our guest Marwa Osman about what's going on in Lebanon, and you know, you've got a fairly good, probably a good take on that situation. Is Lebanon at a crossroads?
Lebanon is broke. First of all, Lebanon is totally broke. If I'm not mistaken, they have only national reserves like $10 billion only. They're right now, as we speak, banks have no banks are going to be closed on Monday. There is not going to be any. There will be no access to dollars. It is really very bad situation financially and economically. But it was brewing for a long time. I mean, Lebanon is a very unique case. Okay, Lebanon is, if you want to see the turbo capitalist society, where nothing is social, nothing except Hezbollah, then you go to Lebanon. You see Maseratis, Ferraris, Lamborghinis driving through potholes next to beggars, next to slums. You go to Marina in Zaytunay Bay. You have yachts. My favorite yacht says, Thank You Daddy number 4, which means, you know, there must be Thank You Dad number 3 and number 2 and number 1, you know? It's totally manic. You go to a cafe, you go to even Starbucks, and waiters are wearing like Armani jackets. You feel like nobody next to them because they're all like they would rather die from hunger, but they would wear expensive clothes. Now, the money comes from where? From plundering West Africa, from narcotics production in Bekaa Valley. And these drugs actually are very dangerous. You know, they also produce combat drugs, and they go through Saudi Arabia to Yemen and to Syria. Okay, these drugs are supposed to make you totally mad, so you can kill anything in sight without... they use these drugs, the Uyghurs use them in Idlib area. They're very dangerous.
Are you talking about Capticon,
yes.
Andre?
Yes. Then banking, the third thing. So basically Lebanon produces very unsavory amount of money, and all this money actually stays in the pockets of the rich people. And the rich people in Lebanon don't care about the poor. They corrupt everything. They strip the country of everything. So now... there was a earlier uprising which was called You Stink, because the government couldn't even clean the garbage from the streets. You know, they have Turkish barges, power plants docked at the coast of Lebanon. They're burning fuel because Lebanon cannot produce electricity. Lebanon is importing electricity from these barges and from war-torn Syria. This is how there is not one public transportation unit in the whole Beirut. There are these minivans, sorry, if you can call it public transportation. There are minivans going, their railroads were never rebuilt. It's a totally grotesque situation. On the other hand, Lebanon is tremendously creative. It's very, Lebanese people are very intelligent. And they always, you know, as designers, as writers, their filmmakers are great, you know, and their academia is very good. So they go abroad and they succeed. But at home, the country is total mess. Nothing works. And it's because of this savage capitalism, because of the involvement of Saudis and all this. The only organization which is taking care of everybody socially is Hezbollah, which is on terrorist list of the West. Again, paradoxically, or understandably, because Hezbollah is fighting Israel historically. You know, with everybody on board, they don't care if it's Shia or Sunni or Christian or atheist. They take everybody to their ranks. So Lebanon is in a very complicated position now. People understood what is happening, and these protests are very legitimate. But it is not like Chile again, because in Chile there is a clear, determined decision to fight for socialism. For justice, for social justice. In Lebanon, they are not there. They have a communist party, they have socialist movements, but their parties are divided along the religious lines. They are until now. Now they talk about possible unity and all that, but there is no culture of unity in Lebanon. So it's a very individualistic country. So I see them protesting, and I love them for what they are doing. I think they're absolutely correct to protest. They have a right to build much better country. But do they know politically what they want? I don't think so. I think they are still searching for... they are too influenced by the West. There is no influence from Asia, for example, in Lebanon. All the influences they know is from Saudi Arabia and France, you know. I mean, plus, of course, U.S. or sometimes Iran, all this. But main reference points are Europe and Saudi Arabia in Gulf. They know nothing about China, zero. They know nothing even about Japan. Forget about communist China, but also capitalist Japan. They know nothing. So, and they know a little bit about West Africa because because they're plundering it. So there are no models really that would inspire them. You know, in Iran, they're very close to Venezuela, for example. South Africa is very close to Venezuela too. There are blocks, there are groups of countries that cooperate. Lebanon is on its own, basically. By influence very negatively for example, Saudi Arabia, because Hariri, he has double citizenship. So whenever Saudi and Lebanese, so whenever he does something, some blunder, they tell him to go to Riyadh and he gets bashing. So it's
so it'll be interesting to see how it plays out. I think the big fear, it's almost in you've laid out a vision for the future or an imperative to try to see something that can work to overcome the systemic problems of Lebanon. But the other thing is there's this big fear, the elephant in the room is that civil war will return again, and that's almost overshadowing any reform, clarity on reform, is the fear of sectarian warfare. This is the thing that Lebanon also suffers from.
It's always there because, of course, it was terrible. The civil war, but also possible invasion, Israeli invasion, which was really devastating for the country, and many other things. And now we have the horror of economic collapse. And you know, it can really happen. They had stolen everything, the elites. You know, I lived there in and out for 5 years. I go to Paris by Air France, and waiting for the luggage, there are all these government officials flying, not business, first class, with their wives decked provocatively in the most expensive designer stuff you can only imagine. These people live in a totally unrealistic world, the elites. They don't care about the poor. Poor people in Lebanon do not exist. They don't, it's not that nobody cares, they just don't exist. You know, everything is about the rich and beautiful. The clubs, you know, you wouldn't believe that you are in a half Muslim country or more. I mean, the clubs where everybody dances half naked, the bars, the theaters, they would die to go and hear old Aznaour singing, the yachts, the Lamborghinis. There are people who drive like at night without mufflers all over Beirut just to impress whom, I don't know. So this is not sustainable because there are people who are starving. There are people who are, there are refugees from all over. Palestinians live, they are treated like animals. They are in the camps like sardines already for years. They cannot do anything. They have several jobs only they can perform. It's terrible. But again, to give credit to Lebanese, they do address all these things. There was a film called Insult exactly about this. All over, it was shown all over the Middle East. So they write books about it, they show films, and they talk about it. They hate their country, and they love their country. So, I mean, you know, it's like a Buenos Aires, me, show, but without anything social. You know, it's like a turbo capitalist Buenos Aires. It's a crazy city. You take the taxi and he starts asking you, what do you think about Lebanon? Is it my country? Isn't it horrible? Isn't it disgusting? I said, no, I actually love it. He stops and gives you a hug because he thinks you actually made it's all he wanted to hear, you know. Well, he hates it, but he also loves it. So that's precisely Lebanese people. And I like them because they are so insane. And as a writer, I like this kind of... I love this kind of ambiance, but you go mad there. You go mad. You cannot drive there because you're scared to die. And in the same time, the crime rate in Lebanon is so low that you can, in a place that survived the civil war, in a place with like millions of refugees, there is no fear to walk on the street. You can just go at 3 in the morning, even if you are a woman, forget about the man. Man has no problem. Even a lady can walk at 2 in the morning, and chances are that nothing will ever happen. It's very safe. in terms of crime. So it's, but the bomb can go off at any moment, you know.
Yeah.
So it's a place which makes you always passionate. You know, one day it can be very positive passion, or the other day it can be very negative. And I think this is how their uprising, this is how their revolution is going to be also managed. Now, I think it's very spontaneous. And it is very sad that there is no stronger intellectual drive to move it. I mean, I would hope that it would go to the left, but it doesn't still. I mean, they say all the right things, but they would never identify themselves with any progressive or left-wing movement.
Yeah, and certainly the U.S. would do anything within its power to keep that from happening, I can assure you.
Of course. And the U.S. is very, it's very complicated relationship. You know, they're bribing them, basically. They're bribing the elites. You know, the money never, they always secure money from the U.S., from especially from Saudis, but also from French. And then what happens? None of this money is invested into infrastructure, into social services, medical care, education. It's all disaster. You have private hospitals, some of the best in the Middle East, but, you know, it's only for the rich. The schools, there's some of the best universities, best educational system, again, for the rich.
Yeah.
For the majority, nothing.
Yeah, it's heartbreaking on a number of levels. I know. I love the country and the people very much.
Yes.
But it's heartbreaking as well at the same time. It's a very difficult one.
What will happen to it? Because if it continues like this, there is no future. I mean, people really are at the edge. They cannot even now withdraw money from the banks. Dollars, it's blocked. So what is going to happen? I don't know. And definitely, I'm going back to Beirut in 3 days. I hope, you know, lives are not lost, because people are not going to accept again Hariri's half measures, like Chileans won't accept Piñera's half measures. But definitely, these countries are fighting for their existence. They are fighting. Chile is fighting for socialism. Lebanon is fighting for its survival. And Hong Kong is fighting for this, for the ego trips and selfie images of its spoiled, you know, totally unruly kids.
So it is a motley tapestry that we're looking at internationally. And well, that's out. We're out of time for this segment, Andre. But hopefully, we can pick up. We'll pick up this thread later on in the future. We'd love to have you back on the program, and we really appreciate you joining us for this episode of the Sunday Wire, Andre.
Patrick, anytime. I would love to talk to you again. Thank you so much for having me.
No, thank you. And if you want to explore some of Andre's work, there's quite a deep volume and archive on his website as well, plus his books. There's a link on the show page, but you can also catch him on RT as well. In the op-ed section, you'll see Andre's work. We also have an archive of Andre's work on 21st Century Wire as well. So I do encourage people to go check out Andre Vilcek on the Sunday Wire this week. We're going to take a short break. We're going to have our final segment of Overdrive for this 300th episode with Basil Valentine, our roving correspondent for culture and sport. We're going to find out what the odds are on Brexit. Will Britain actually leave? Basil has new odds on that. This is the Sunday Wire. I'm your host, Patrick Henningsen. Stick around. We'll see you in a minute.
I hear there's rumors on the internets.
Dying.